Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day.
We thank you because we still have the grace to call you Father.
We thank you because of your love that has drawn us to yourself.
Thank you, Lord, for giving us the gift of faith
to believe in you
and to know that Christ is our Lord and Savior.
Father, we are praying that this faith in Christ will effectually work in our hearts and lives in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, that the biblical kind of faith and the biblical evidence of faith will be in our lives in Jesus' name. That, Lord, as we live our lives, it will be a life that is lived by faith and faith alone. Father, we pray that we'll know more of the victory that comes through faith. Help us, Lord, and help us to live the life of faith that so glorifies your name and so reveals you to the world around us. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name, we pray. Today we want to talk once again about faith. And the aspect of faith we're talking about is the victory that faith normally wins. The subject or the topic I'm addressing is faith's greatest victory. Faith's greatest victory. There are all kinds of victory we can talk about that faith can win. But we want to be able to identify the greatest victory that faith wins. Let's look at Hebrews, a familiar chapter that talks on faith. This epistle to the Hebrews actually talks much about faith, about believing in God, and about holding on in faith, holding fast in faith. And then before it closes, it tells us in Hebrews chapter 11 of the heroes of faith. And these heroes of faith actually did a number of things by the faith they possessed in God. But then we need to ask ourselves, of all these victories of faith, which would we count as the greatest? And what should be our aim today as to the kind of victory that we ought to have or we ought to win by faith? Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Here this verse tells us the importance of faith. The essence of faith is in verse 1. But here in verse 6, we have the importance of faith. That in fact, without faith, it is impossible to please him. You and I know that people are looking for a lot of things in life. Even in the Christian fold, people are looking for a lot of things. And yet, we are told, of all the things we can aim at, desire, and try to possess, we're told that this is very great. This is very important. That is faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. So that means that you should desire to have more faith. And if you don't already have faith in Christ, you should desire to have faith in Christ and manifest that kind of faith that will please the Lord. Then it says, for he that believeth, he that cometh to God, must believe that God is, that he really exists, and that he is who he says he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You see, the faith we're talking about here has the object as the Almighty God. You will see that it says, he that cometh to God must believe that God is, and that God is a rewarder of them that are diligently seeking after God. So then, the object is not the world. The object is not in success, in quotes. The object is not in myself or in yourself. There are people that say they believe in success. That's not the kind of faith we're talking about. We're talking of believing in God. Other people will say they believe in themselves, that whatever their mind can conceive, they can achieve. We're not talking about that kind of faith. We're talking about the kind of faith that has its object as God Almighty Himself. Without that kind of faith, faith in God, faith in the existence of God, faith in the love of God, faith in the providence of God, faith in the salvation of God, faith in all that God has done, God is doing, God will do, and faith in the program and plan of God. Without faith in God, it is impossible to please God. A man may have faith in himself, trust in man, confidence in material riches or material possession. That isn't the height of faith. The height of faith is having faith in God, believing that God is, believing that God is a rewarder, believing that God knows everything that we do, and He rewards the people that seek Him, diligently seek Him. I said it's the importance of faith. Let's look at the essence of faith itself in verse 1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. This is faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And as we look at this, you will see this is the kind of the faith of Abraham. He hoped for things that he had not seen. He believed in the things that had not actually appeared. And that is faith. He so believed in God. In Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4, verse 16. Therefore, it is of faith, that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were. You can see the object of Abraham's faith. It wasn't faith in himself, faith in material things, faith in others, or trust and confidence in others. We are talking about faith in God. That is, he believed, even in God, the God that quickens the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were. Look at verse 18. Who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And be not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Here you can see that the object of his faith was God. And God ought to be the object of your faith and the object of my faith. Verse 21, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. Therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Let's go back to Hebrews chapter 11. Verse 1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The essence of faith is that you walk contrary to sight. Now, what we call sight in Scripture is not only what you see, it's what you feel, It's what you think in the natural. It's what you have in the natural. And it also includes what you can see in the natural. There are people that will say, if I don't see, I cannot jump. If I don't fully understand, I cannot move on. If I don't feel right, I cannot take any step. They depend on how they feel. They depend on what they see. They depend on what they are sure of naturally. They say, tell me, give me a promise, and affirm it by this and by that. They say they need all that before they can move. Now, faith is the substance of things we're hoping for. We've not got it, we're hoping for it. We've not seen it, we're hoping for it. We do not even feel it now, we're hoping for it. And we're not very near, it's not even at sight, but we're hoping for it. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen. You see, that's the essence of faith. Faith in God. And by and large, I can say that those of us who have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, we have that kind of faith. You've not seen Calvary, yet you believe. You've not seen actually Christ agonizing on the cross of Calvary, yet you believe. There are a lot of things you have not seen, but because you have heard, because you have looked at it in the Word of God, you actually believe. And that's exactly what Jesus said to Thomas. He said, you believe because you have seen me. But blessed are those who have not seen, yet have believed. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. Reading from verses 7 and 8. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom, having not seen, ye love. In whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. That's what we're talking about. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You've not seen the Lord in the physical. Maybe some people have seen him in vision. Some people might have seen him in a revelation or in a dream. And glory to God for revealing himself to you that way. But now we're talking about seeing him in the natural. Peter the apostle here says, whom having not seen, ye love. You know that he was born in Bethlehem. How do you know that? You were not there. You didn't see that. Thank God you have faith in that. And you know that he lived a perfect, innocent, sinless, holy life. You were not here on earth then. How do you know that? You believe. Thank God you are a believer. And he went to the cross and he died. And you know that the people that witnessed against him, they were false witnesses. How do you know that? You were not there. Thank God you believe. And he went to the cross of Calvary. He was nailed to the cross. And he died for your sins, died for my sins, died for the sins of the whole world. How do you know that? You were not there. Thank God you believe. And that's what the Bible is saying here. Whom having not seen, ye love. Because he loved you so much. And because he died for you. You hold on to that. In whom, though now, ye see him not, yet believing. You have not seen him in the natural, in the physical, yet believing. Ye rejoice with joy unspeakable, full of glory. What's the result of that? Receiving the end of your faith. That is, receiving the result of that faith in God, even the salvation of your soul. I've spoken to you about the importance of faith. I've also spoken about the essence of faith. That faith is the evidence of things not seen. But now, what are the victories of faith? What are the kind of things that faith does, produces in our lives
And which are we going to call the greatest? Let's look at Hebrews chapter 11 again. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world, and became the heir of the righteousness which is by faith. Here we talk about Noah. Noah believed in God. He was warned of things not seen yet, that a flood will come, and the flood will drown all the people of the world except the few that believe. And he believed in God. He prepared an ark, and he prepared that ark by believing God. He moved with faith, and he feared God, and that fear of God made him to hurry up and to do what he needed to do, the time he needed to do it, so that his family and the people that believe will be saved from the deluge or from the flood. But then look at this. He prepared the ark by faith, and then his home, his house, his family, they were saved by faith. It says saving, to the saving of his house. Well, that's natural deliverance. They didn't perish in the flood. But then it says something. He became the heir of righteousness. He inherited righteousness, which is by faith. Now you can see there, which is the greatest victory? That he escaped destruction by the flood, that's not the greatest. That he was able to prepare the ark of safety, that's not the greatest. What's the greatest? That man, sinful man, born in sin, conceived in iniquity, and had lived in sin before he found the grace of God in his life, that such a man, a sinner, could become a saint and could inherit righteousness by faith. I dare tell you, that is the greatest victory that faith can win. When faith wins victory over temptation, the temptation of the flesh, the temptations that are coming from the world, and the harassment and the fierce temptation from the devil, and man, instead of yielding to sin, will so believe in Christ and become righteous and live a righteous life and live a pure life and be totally free from sin and be full of holiness, that is the greatest victory that faith can win. Look at verse 8. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should hereafter, which should after receive for an inheritance, he obeyed. He went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. Now, let's stop there for a moment. We see here the faith of Abraham. And he possessed the place that God had promised him. He went out of where he had been before, and he got to the land of promise. Look at it in verse 9. By faith, he sojourned. He stayed. He lived in the land of promise. Now, would you say that that's the greatest kind of faith a man can have? And that's the greatest result faith can produce? No. You see, the obedience. Obedience to the word of God. Obedience to the commandment of God. That's the greatest thing here. And that's what we read about before. Let's look at it again. In Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4, in verse 20 to 22, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform, and therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. That's the greatest victory faith won in his life. He inherited the land. That's only land. But you tell me, was it everybody that stepped on the land of Canaan that got to heaven eventually? No, not at all. But you know, without holiness, we cannot see the Lord. And it is that holiness It is that righteousness. It is that purity. It is that freedom from sin that is the greatest victory that faith can win. And that's what we're told about Abraham. That faith was imputed unto him for righteousness. The righteousness of faith. The fact that he stopped being a sinner and became a saint in the Lord. That's the greatest victory that faith can win. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 11 once again. Verse 11. Through faith also, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. That's a great kind of faith, Sarah. When she was so much of age, in fact, she had passed the age, she could have any child. And eventually, she so believed in God that she conceived. And she brought forth Isaac. Oh, you say, I need that kind of faith. It's wonderful when somebody can believe in God. When the doctors have said the person cannot have any child anymore. When the doctors have said tubes are blocked. The fibroids will not allow the child to even grow, even if there was conception. And eventually the person says, I believe in God. I believe in God. And eventually she conceives. And fibroid or not, blocked tubes or not, eventually she delivers a real baby. And the baby that is growing strong. You know that is faith. And we thank God for that faith. But listen to me. Some people have got that kind of faith. And they have got children. But they have not been born again. They have not been saved. They have not become free from sin. Other people, apparently, they appeared as if they were born again. They were children of God. And they believed God while they became pregnant. You know, they were saying, oh, I praise God. I will never leave God. When they delivered, when the child was being named, oh, they were all full of jubilation during the celebration. I believe in God. I trust in God. I will never leave him. But we know some of the people, they are backsliding. They've gone back into the life of sinning. They have not been able to overcome temptation, trial, persecution. They've gone back into the world. And you know, their parents, everything now, even though they had the faith to conceive and to bring forth children. You know what I'm telling you? That's not the greatest victory that faith can win. A person may be able to conceive and have children and yet not be able to make heaven if he does not have the faith that wins the victory over sin, over the flesh, over the world, and over the devil as well. What are we saying then? We're saying the faith that makes a person righteous, the faith that makes a person holy, the faith that makes a person free from sin, every form of sin, all kinds of sin, that is a faith that will be able to please God eventually. Let's look at this in verse 20. By faith Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. Here is another kind of faith. Again, look at this. Are we going to say this is the greatest victory that faith can win? Before Isaac died, he called his sons and he blessed them, and every word he spoke became fulfilled. That patriarch was also a prophet. He spoke the word, it was confirmed even after he had died. And we would say that is faith. And we have enjoyed that in the church here. When the Lord will use any of us, maybe the pastor, maybe our coordinator, maybe another brother or another sister, where that sister will open her mouth in faith, where the brother will open his mouth in faith, and he will say the word of blessing. And that blessing, even after that brother might have been transferred to another district or transferred to another town, that word of promise, that word of anointing, authority becomes fulfilled in you. We thank God for that. We praise the name of the Lord for that. But wait a minute. Is that the greatest thing that faith can do? Once we have that and we give out the blessing, and the blessing comes upon the person we are blessed, is that the greatest thing? No, not at all. No, not at all. Look at this. Matthew chapter 7, from verse 21. Matthew chapter 7 from verse 21. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? In thy name have we cast out devils, and in thy name have we done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. You see that? I may be able to pronounce blessing on a brother, on a sister, on a family. Thank God that that's available in the church too. You may be able to pronounce the blessing on a brother, on a sister, on a family. Thank God that you have developed your faith to the point you can tell a sick sister and you can say, never mind sister, you will get well, and that's it, she will get well. Or you might say, brother, never mind that collapsing business, it will come up again, you will progress. Thank God for that word of authority. Thank God for that word of power. Thank God for that word of faith that brings a change in the life, in the family, in the business of the other people. And eventually, it is so. Thank God for it. But you know, there's something greater. Because you know, we can do all that. We can say all that. We can bring all those blessings and not be free from sin. And you know, God sees more than human beings can see. There may be that sin right there in the heart. Hiding in the heart. Hiding in your very system, and you refuse to get rid of it, and you do not have the faith that overcomes that sin. You know what? On the last day, you will find that pronouncing blessing on other people is not the greatest kind of victory that faith can win. It is much more than that. So that's why I'm talking to you tonight on faith's greatest victory. And you can see over here from all that I've read to you that the greatest victory that faith can win is when a sinner comes to the Lord and he bows the knee before the Lord. He turns away from all his sins and he says, Lord, here am I. Have mercy upon me. And he so believes in God that he becomes saved. Please wait a minute. Let me explain to you what the Bible calls salvation. Because we meet a lot of people today, and they talk about being saved. They talk about being born again. They talk about being regenerated. And they say they are just children of God. But let me tell you what the Bible means when it says we are saved, or we are born again, or we have been regenerated. Look at Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, verse 28. Romans chapter 3 verse 28. Therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. A man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. The word justify, it's the word that is taken out of the law court. You see, in those days and even still today, when a man has been condemned and is found guilty, and there are evidences or witnesses against him that he was guilty, the next thing will be that he was expecting judgment. If then somebody will come to his rescue and become a substitute, eventually he could be set free, discharged and acquitted. That state of being discharged and acquitted, that state of being set free, not to face the judgment anymore, and counted as if he had never committed a sin, never committed a crime, never done anything wrong, is what we read about in our New Testament, that we are justified. And before God, we have all been guilty. It says it in Romans, that all the world may become guilty before the Lord. That's in verse 19 of Romans chapter 3. Now, we know that what things soever the Lord says, it says to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. I was guilty before God. You were guilty before God. All creatures all over the world were guilty before God. No matter how clean you think you have lived, the stars are not pure in his sight, much less the children of men, much less anyone that came out of a woman. We have been unclean. We have been sinners. In fact, verse 23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We have all sinned. And we have been guilty before God. And we came before the Lord, before the judgment seat, so to say. What were we expecting? Judgment, wrath, indignation, punishment. We were not good. Don't listen to the people that says we have something inherently good in us. Nothing like that. Nothing like that. Don't listen to anybody that says, even before I became a Christian, there was something good, something great, something high within myself, waiting to be revealed and waiting to be dug out, so that you will see there was something great within. No, we were all guilty before God. Psychology may say something else. And the people that have a secret cause may say something else. Those in fraternal societies may say there's something hidden in man, great thing, whatever name they call it. But no, we were bad. We were evil. And we were reprobates in the sight of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But then, we would have been condemned to death. And would have faced the eternal judgment of God. Punishment forever and ever and ever. But we came to the Lord. And we have faith in Christ. Christ that took away our sins. Behold the Lamb of God. We looked up and we couldn't see any goodness of ours. We looked up and we couldn't see any righteousness of ours. We saw only Christ. And we saw the blood by faith dripping down. And he said, this is what I did for you. I died for you. I shed my blood for you. You don't have to perish. Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. By faith we drew near. By faith we looked up to his eyes of love. By faith we embraced him. By faith we said, can you forgive me? Can you change my life? By faith we said, we exchanged our sin for his righteousness. And then the witness come in our hearts, our sins were forgiven. Everything was cleansed away. We began to rejoice. The joy of salvation filled our hearts. That faith brought righteousness unto us. And the Spirit of God assured us no more condemnation. The debt has been paid. The guilt has been removed. We are now the children of God. We go out of those, out of that court, out of that place that was meant for condemnation. And we came out with justification. We are no more condemned, but we are now in Christ. We are no more sinners, but we are now righteous. And we go out of that place confident in God that all our sins were taken away. Confident also that the days ahead will be lived by the grace of God. That we who have been servants of sin will now become the servants of righteousness. Brothers and sisters here tonight, that is the greatest victory that faith can win. And when you maintain that righteousness, that victory over sin, that victory over the world, that victory over the flesh, it is the greatest kind of victory that faith can win in your life. Please look up here. Do you know, we as Christians, we may soon forget this. And we may begin to think about getting healed. That is great. Don't misunderstand me. When we believe in God and we get healed, that is great. That is marvelous. But all I'm telling you is this. That's not the greatest victory that faith can win. It may be that somebody is oppressed by evil spirits. And we just have a program and we just tell that evil spirit to get out. And you are delivered. And that is wonderful. That is wonderful. I will not take anything from the Bible. And I will still tell you that Jesus said, he that believeth in me, the works I do, he shall do. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They'll cast out devils. It is great. It is wonderful. But listen to me. Somebody can have devils cast out of him. And he may still continue lying. He may still continue committing adultery and fornication. He may still continue stealing. And the thing that is walking up and down in the body, the heat in the body, the moving object in the body, that thing is cast out. And yet, there is still a weakness in the character. And yet, there is still sin in the behavior and the conduct. And there is still the anger in the life or in the heart. There is still this wrath and malice still living in the heart. I'm saying that it is wonderful to get delivered. It is wonderful to get healed. But the greatest victory, the greatest victory that faith can win, is when you become free from sin. When you become free from sin. And listen to me, brothers and sisters. Isn't this what the Bible says? Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Does it say, without healing, no man shall see the Lord? No. Lazarus was sick, full of sores all over. But he died and he went to heaven. He went to heaven. It's not that without healing no man can see the Lord. We can be sick and still love the Lord. We can be sick and still be holy. We can be sick and still be righteous. Does it say without prosperity, without money, without material things, without the best job in town, no man can see the Lord? No, he doesn't say that. No, he doesn't say that. Lazarus that I refer to now, did he have the greatest job in town? Did he have great prosperity and a lot of money? No, not at all. Holiness. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. You know, we make a great mistake when we concentrate all our faith, all our prayer on prosperity. When all the prayer requests we have, all the desires we have, everything is consecrated or concentrated on, I need a job, I need money, I need material things. If we're not careful, we can make money our God. If we're not careful, material things can become our Lord. If we're not careful, a good job, a good personality, and good possession, and these things of the world can become our God that we're worshipping and bowing down to. But no, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Let's look at 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5 and in verse 4. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. You know, I praise the Lord for people who are born again outside Deeper Life Bible Church. You know, sometimes we Deeper Life people, we sometimes talk as if it's only within this small church you can find people who are born again. But it's not true. Thank God for the people that are born again outside Deeper Life. We are not the whole church. We are just part of the church of God. Part of the church of Christ. But listen to me. Sometimes our fellow brothers and fellow sisters who are born again outside Deeper Life, they have great faith for getting money, great faith for prosperity, great faith for healing, great faith for being a good personality, great faith for this, great faith for that, but they don't have the faith that overcomes the world. And the worldliness, there's no faith to overcome that worldliness. And the thinking of the world, and the ways of the world, and the system of the world, the customs of the world, they do not have the faith that overcomes the customs of the world. And that is something they need to work at. That is something they need to work at. Now, let's look inward here in the church. There are a lot of us too that may not know that we do not think like the world. We do not walk like the world. We do not fight like the world. We do not do things like the world. You see, the people of the world, they have a way of getting their way through. They have a way of emphasizing this is the way things should go, especially in politics. When you come into the church and you do something like that, you know, it means you have not overcome the world. In your mind, your thoughts, your attitude, your imagination, and your air, your posture, the way you look, and everything around you, if it is like the world, the greatest victory you can win by faith is to overcome the world. The world will bring suggestion, and you will read about what they are doing in the world. This is how they do it in the world. This is how they do it in the world. But the faith that overcometh the world, that's the greatest kind of victory that faith can win. Whosoever is born of God overcometh the world. Look at yourself. Are you like the world? You need to overcome that thing. Do you think like the world? Do you talk like the world? Do you act like the world? Do you dress like the world? Do you plan like the world? Do you fight like the world? Do you get your way through like the world? Let me tell you what I mean. In a family, in the world, there is a way that the wife can have her way before the husband. The wife can use some kind of method. Either the wife can threaten and say, I am going. If you don't give me this, if you don't buy this for me, if you don't change this car that I've been using for 5 years now, and I know you have the money, if you don't change the car, I'm leaving. It means you don't love me. And by threatening and crying and forcing and reporting to other people and connecting this and connecting that, eventually the man will give up and say, here we are, I'm sorry about this, now have the car. Now you are a Christian. As a Christian wife, you just put a pressure on your husband. You are not getting that thing by faith. You are not getting that thing by prayer. You are not getting that thing through love. You are not getting that thing by being acting as a Christian. You act like the world. You threaten. Maybe you are even pretending. You pack your load and you act as if I'm going. Oh, my sister, what's the matter? Well, you don't love me anymore. And I've been asking you to do this for me, buy this car for me, buy that for me. You are not doing it. My sister, that's the world. That's the way they get it in the world. That's the way they act in the world. Don't do that. Let your faith overcome the world. And that's the greatest kind of victory we can have. You know, you can get whatever you like in this world. If you get it by worldly method, there's no glory in it. Read it again. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Let our faith make us to win the victory over the world and over sin. 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3, reading from verse 6. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth has not seen him, neither known him. Brothers and sisters, in the early days of this ministry, Deep Alive, the way we used to measure our Christian life, our Christian maturity, is the victory we had over sin. Oh, we say, praise the Lord for me. Praise the Lord for me. I used to be this, I used to be that, but now God has given me the victory. I just rejoice in the Lord. I didn't know I could stop smoking or drinking or lying. I used to fight a lot. And I used to just live careless life. Careless life. I didn't know I could ever be pure. Pure in language. Pure in my thoughts. Pure in my imagination. I was very bad. But you know, I've been born again now. I believe in God now. And I'm not proud. I'm just telling you, by the grace of God, God has set me free from sin. It's not by my power. Not by my might. It is by the grace of God. It is by the Spirit of God. He has set me free. That was our joy. You know, over the years, this is unfortunate now, over the years, things have changed. You know, how we measure our Christian life now, oh, praise the Lord with me, I've got a new baby. Well, that's good. There's something greater. Praise the Lord for me, I've got a new job. That's good. There's something greater. Praise the Lord for me, things that were working my body before, they are no more there. That's great. That's great. But there's something greater. Praise the Lord for me. You know, now anything, I just name it, I claim it, I have it. Well, maybe that's good, but there's something greater. You know what's greater? The victory that makes you to overcome sin. Let's go back to the Bible. Let's go back to the reality of the Christian faith. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever, even a new convert, whosoever, a real child of God, sinneth not. Wonderful day it will be when sin is out of our lives entirely. And it can be, because this is the reason Jesus Christ was born. ye shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. If that is not done in your life and in my life, whatever else we get through prayer and faith, everything will be useless in the light of eternity. But when we overcome sin, when we live in righteousness, that will be great. You know, in this church, by the grace of God now, we rejoice. We rejoice that we have thousands of people that believe in God and come to deeper life. Thousands, thousands, thousands of people. In this city alone, thousands of people. And you know, our joy today is that we will say, I belong to deeper life. And you know how many thousands we are? But think about this. How many of these thousands in this city are living free from sin? How many of the thousands in this church are living completely righteous lives? How many of the people that say, I will die with deeper life. I will die in deeper life. I am of deeper life. Deeper life is my church. Some can even exchange blows to argue and to defend deeper life. You see that? Some can even drive away their wives and say, if you don't go to deeper life with me, I'm going to break the marriage vow. You see that? Some people can even be disrespectful to their manager or their boss in the place of work. If you insult my church, I'm ready to slap you. You see that? You see that? But you know, the joy that this church should have is not the joy of the crowd. I like people to come. I like us to have even double that we have, more than what we have now, but the joy is not the number. The joy is not the many thousands. The joy is not how many people we have that mention the name deeper life. The joy is that we're free from sin. We're free from sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth has not seen him, neither known him. Look at the word, whosoever. Whosoever, whosoever you are, whosoever, whatever position you may have, if you are living in sin, you have not known Christ. You have not seen Christ. And if we count you as a member of the visible church, you are not a member of the invisible church. And isn't that what matters? What's the glory? If I'm a member of the visible church here, but I'm not a member of the invisible church, up above, whosoever sinneth has not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil. Mark it in your Bible. Whosoever. 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 He that committeth sin is of the devil. You don't have to be a policeman over other people and be watching at sister so-and-so is committing sin, she's of the devil. No, no, don't do that. Brother so-and-so is committing sin, she's of the devil. No, don't do that. And be misinterpreting people's action and so and such, don't do that. Only check your life. Only check your life. Am I free from sin? Do I have the faith that overcomes sin? Do I have the faith that lives a righteous life? Turn the searchlight on yourself, not on other people. It says in verse 8, he that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Are there the works of the devil in my life? God wants to destroy them. Are there the works of the devil in your life? God wants to destroy them. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. Beautiful verse. Wonderful verse. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin. Thank God. He cannot sin. He will not sin. He does not desire to sin, and is going to avoid sin of all shape, of all sizes. He cannot sin. He will not sin, because he is born of God. That's the greatest victory that faith can win. Faith's greatest victory is to be free from sin. Look at this. Look at this. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14. Follow peace with all men and holiness. And holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. A man can get healed and go to hell. A man can get delivered from evil spirits and still go to hell. A man can have the best job in town by prayer and still go to hell. A man can have the highest position anywhere and still go to hell. A man can have all the things that I can see, all the things that mind can conceive, and still go to hell. There's one thing. Not two things, one thing. There is one single thing that takes a man from earth to heaven. That is holiness. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Isn't that the greatest thing I can possess today? The greatest thing I can possess today. You know, in the past, people didn't call me pastor. In the past, people didn't call me GS. They just say brother. They just say bro. And today, you know, anywhere I go, people say GS, people say pastor. But that doesn't take me to heaven. And if I'm just called bro, I think that's great. Just to be a brother to Jesus Christ and your brother. And your brother. I may have a little I can teach you. I may have a little I can explain to you. But I'm still your brother. And I don't mind you calling me brother and she calling me brother. Because the greatest thing I can have is not a title. The greatest thing I can have is holiness. And the same thing with you, my brother, my sister. The greatest thing you can have is not a title. The greatest thing you can have is not holiness. That holiness. Holiness within, holiness without. Holiness with your fellow sister, holiness with your fellow brother. Holiness when no man is there, holiness when people are there. Holiness when you are with your boss, holiness when you are not with your boss. Holiness when you are your village, holiness when you are amidst the people of God. Holiness among the workers, holiness among the members. Holiness in your thoughts, holiness in your action, holiness in your desires, in your aspiration, in your ambition. Holiness in your comportment, holiness in your dressing, holiness everywhere. Holiness in every way possible without holiness. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Are we holy enough? If the rapture should take place right now, if the trumpet should sound right now, if the Lord should say the end of history is coming on, get ready, and the end has come. Come on home. Come on home. Are we ready? Are we prepared? Are we holy enough for heaven yet? Has our hearts been purified? Our nature purged and our actions completely corrected? Are we holy in the sight of God? Without holiness. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Why don't you rise up? Why don't you rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer? The greatest victory that faith can win. The greatest victory that faith can win is not getting healed. When we get healed, great. Great, great and wonderful. But when we possess holiness, when we possess purity, when we possess real sanctification and holiness of life, that is the greatest victory that faith can win. Talk to the Lord tonight. And you tell the Lord, I want to be holy. You talk to the Lord, I want to be pure. You talk to the Lord, I want to be who God wants me to be. I don't mean position, I mean possession of a holy kind of life. Talk to the Lord in prayer. Let the Lord turn the searchlight on your heart, on your attitude, on your desires, on everything within and without. And make sure that before you go from here tonight, you have that holiness that God is looking for.